Hello, fellow mapmakers. Welcome to tonight's live mapmaking session. Hope you're all fine and good and that you can hear me. Please let me know if my sound is bad or anything is wrong with the transmission. But from this side, it seems to be looking good. Alright, tonight I'm gonna do a session by popular request. We had a few... No? Okay. Conflicting information here. Only Sue has no sound. Sorry about that, Sue, but perhaps your sound is off somewhere. Everybody else seems to be hearing me. Okay, hope Sue gets it sorted out. So we'll just continue. But as usual, if you have any questions, post them in the chat. Sue and I will take a look. Okay, good. Sue had me on mute. Heard me too much already today, probably. So we're good to go. As I was saying, if you have any questions, post them in the chat and Sue will forward them to me and I'll see that I can answer them and see that I can help out with anything. It's a session on a topic that was requested by some viewers on houses and streets in City Designer and some of the other City Designer features, and as such I'll see what I can cover of this today. And see how we get on, how far we get. We'll not be creating a full map today, so I'm looking more in detail at some commands. So I've loaded up a map from two sessions ago, which I can work on. Good. So let's have a look here. I'm working on a map that in Sue's Darkland City style, which we published a few weeks ago. And I did a session 2 weeks ago on this, and this is the map that came out of that live mapping session. And since we're doing city stuff anyway, we can just continue working on this. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to erase my starting text, because we're not waiting anymore. So I'll just click the erase button here up on the left side, then select my text by clicking on the baseline. Remember always, if you use the mouse click to select text, you have to hit the baseline. And then press D for do it. Refresh my screen. And then my text is gone. Now I'm going to zoom in and to a section I want to work on. It's down here. Last time I just plopped down a few houses very quickly, and I want to clean this up and do some new stuff and use that as an opportunity to use some of the city tools. For that, I'm going to erase some of the buildings here and make room for new stuff. Just basically do a little bit of renovating work in the city. Just click on the edges of the house symbols here, make some room, and say this, I want to create this as a central piece of the town and do some work on the houses here. Press D for do it, refresh, and there's my empty reconstruction area, which I can now work on. So first thing I want to look at is the house command. Of course, you can always use the symbols to place down houses, but they are in fixed shapes, and sometimes you want to use some specific house shapes to create some layouts that the symbols don't have, or want some other control over the buildings, and the house command is perfect for that. So uh, Say we want a big building here somewhere, an inn or something on the crossroads. So I'm going to go up to the house button and click the house command. That brings up the insert building dialog, where I can set all my settings for the house. First off, I've got different roof settings in here in the house settings list. It comes up selected with the default style for the default roofs house settings for the style, marked with CA177 because that's the annual number to tell them apart. And you can see we've got thatches which are look older than the metric versions. We are working on imperial map here in feet, so we're not going to use the M metric versions, but choose one of these. We could also go in and go into settings and create new ones. Let's take a look what we can do. So let's choose the default setting here. Click settings, and that brings up into the detailed information on the roof style, where we can do all kinds of different settings. For example, just we've got the roof ridge here. On the house, if we wanted to build it without roof ridges, we could just turn this off, or we could make it wider and smaller and so on settings. But what I recommend, if you do that, first save the setting as a new one. So let's say it custom, then we can work on different things here. For example, we've got a house style here, which basically defines the edges of the roofs. We've got things here like shingles that we can add. These are from symbol set 5, thatched for edges. This Gothic setting we are using at the moment is kind of irregular shapes of the roof of an older, broken, not really broken down, but very much used roof. Was this Gothic setting here. And let's have a look. What else do we have? See, thatched. This is even scragglier, like pieces of thatch sticking out from the roof. If you want something simple, or simple shapes, you can choose blank. And lots of different options here. We're going to go back to our existing setting. What we can, if you wanted a different roof color here, I can choose different fill styles. We've got the slate brown setting here for the roof color. Let's have a look what else we can do. We've got the stone setting here. And thatches. That's the H thatch that we already have in a different style. So for the moment, we've got these are all the fill styles defined in the map. Gonna stick with our slate setting. Here you can set the steepness of the roof. Steep roofs will give stronger shadows. Shallow will make the roofs lighter. Flat will have no shadow on the roof at all. Let's do some shallower roofs here, less strong shadows as a difference. Well, you've got settings for if you do flat roofs, how wide the edge is, and all the kinds of different things. I'm not going to go into detail of all of those. For the moment, a little change with the shallow roof pitch should be sufficient. And let's go back to our house catalog. Very importantly, you can set the different shapes here. Basically, these give you lots of different options how to draw your roofs. Some are very useful to do connecting buildings where you have to have very irregular roof shapes like this one. And you can also do some regular polygon shaped roofs, which can be nice for special cathedrals or wizard towers and so on. So we're going to do a big building with two wings. start with, and for that we're gonna choose this fairly complex shape, as you can see here. We can also have different roof types. We've got the angled roofs that are angled on the sides. I forget how the English expression is to for these gables. And once houses, some of them will only apply to certain roof types. For example, this doesn't work on this roof type. We had to go to the basic house shape. Then we just had a cross-shaped roof without a middle ridge. This is the flat roof type. We're going to stick with the side edges here as we have in the main map. Yeah, lean-to roof. This okay, for the lean-tos we have additions like from the symbol catalogs. You can't do a lean-to roof just from the house building on its own. You could put it beneath another house to only show the middle. But you can't draw only one roof side with the house tool. It will always have two roof sides and a gable in the middle, basically. But you can do extensions, which we'll cover in a moment. So let's have a look. And first draw our in with the two wings. For that, we're going to start. The command line tells us the house shape. And I can switch to different types in mid-command with a tap. So we've got go back to our 6 irregular U. So then we define the front edge of our building. Then the major layout. Large building. One wing. And then basically the other wing, but already did it a little bit wrong from what I wanted to, because I didn't remember the proper sequence of the house points. But see, this way we have a long, thin U shape, and I wanted to change this and redo this house. Here we go, like this. And I want to start up here, and then if I build the two wings this way, I can make them wider. So there's our big house shape. Nice and good. But we do want a couple extra additions on the house. Should be a sprawling building. And for that, I'm going to go into the house command again and take a look at the extras here. So I can put an extension in here. Click insert. This is house shape 10 extension, and it asked me to click a point within the house. That would be here. Then the house edge. Then the how far my extension extends from the house. And then the width. And here we've got a nice extension. Now let's have a look how we want to draw another house here next to this. This time I'm gonna do something simpler, just a basic house shape. Insert. Angled a little bit. Here we go. And now I want to connect these with an extension. We've got a connecting extension for this. Insert. Point within the house. House edge. Next house edge, and then we built. Well, this didn't quite work as I wanted. Perhaps the angle was a little bit off. What I can do is I can just move around this house a little bit. There we go. That fits better. Now, Vivan asked about a lean-to. And how would I do this if I just wanted to use the house command for that? I could go in and use one of our house parts from the uh, symbol catalog and attach this to the house. You can see it aligns to that just as it would to align to normal house symbols. But I wanted to use the house command, so I'm going to click the house again. I'll choose a free form house shape. And then I just draw it halfway down into this building here. And then use center back to move the lean-to beneath the other house building. And this way we do have a lean-to roof here. As you can see, we have a nice big sprawling complex of buildings here, big inn with some side buildings added to over the years. So how do you make the, I've got another question from Patrick, how do you make the colors lighter or darker? First off, as we did previously, we can go into the house settings and just simply choose the different roof pitches. That will allow us to create various roof darkness stages within the same map. But what we can also do, this would be the custom one. Oh, actually, something didn't save here. If I go into the settings again, oh, it should have saved us. I think I didn't save the custom settings when I changed that. See, and if I now draw another house here, next to this, this is lighter because the roof is shallower, so casts less shadow. What you can, we can also do if we want to change this over the whole map is we can go in and change the global sun settings. For that, we click on the hourglass and then the take the global sun option. And here we can set the intensity of the global lighting. So for example, we are at 100% now. If I reduce that to 50%, you can see the shadows become much less strong. And if I go up to 200%, our shadows get much darker and more visible. So we have control over that here. What you can also do, you can change the direction our sun is coming from. At the moment, it's coming from 135 degrees, measured from straight to the right. So it's coming from the upper left. If I'd say I wanted it to come from the upper right, I'd do 45 degree. And suddenly, the shadows are on this side of the buildings. Or if you wanted to have a south-south western sun, it would be 225 degrees, and see our shadows are on the upper right side of the buildings. And let's perhaps make the intensity 125%. And that way we can move the sun around, show different times of the day, even different seasons for stronger and weaker lights, and so on. So that was working on the house symbols. Next up, we are gonna take a look at the street settings. What you gotta remember though is that these are still separate entities. Each building that you create, that you draw, each house is a group of entities. Competitor groups them into one, and so you can move them around. But since we are using the house command in different separate stages, each extension and each extra house is a separate group. So if I use the move command on this, it will only grab this main piece which I drew first, and I'd have to select all of them separately to move them around on their own. What I could do is, if I wanted to really group, have them be one entity, I could go on and group all these. So grouping some groups, tools, groups group, and then select all the things I want to stick together, but I did not want to take the green grass. It's looking good. And now I could go on and move this all in one go. So this will basically behave as one piece. It gets fairly complicated, and then Campaign Cartographer just draws the bounding box instead of the outlines of all the entities. And I'll ungroup this for now. Oh, we can leave this as a group. Good. So much for that. Although, no, let's undo the grouping for now. What did happen, which is a bit strange, that we have the darker shadow on this now. This is a bit, don't quite know. Did I copy anything? Oh, I know what happened. When I grabbed these as a group, it moved all the entities onto the sheet I was currently on, because groups always have to be on the same sheet together, and it takes the sheet that I'm currently working on. So I accidentally moved everything to the text sheet. So good opportunity to show where they should really belong. We're just going to move them back onto their buildings. Or where are we? On the building sheet. There we are. And there we've got the correct look again. So what does the street command do? The street command just puts multiple houses along one street automatically, partly randomly. And that makes it very easy and quickly to fill out larger sections of a city. For that to show, we're gonna right-click the road, the street command, and have a look at the basic settings here. Basically, again, we've got settings prefaced with the CA177 for the annual number, and then a variety of different settings in different shapes and selections of building colors to show different house types, neighborhoods, basically, you know, some data really small huts in bad condition, larger houses for better, more affluent city districts, and so on. What can I control here? I could either say all houses are the same and then select the house section. So it looks rather boring. Oh, see, there's a little strange thing with the dialogue here. It doesn't show which one is unselected once I've moved here. But we know it's on random houses here. Something to note for the bug list, I think. I should actually, the unselected one should go away. And what you can set here is what percentage of the different house shapes you want to show up. See, you've got these five basic types, and depending on the numbers you put in here, when you place down a street, Campaign Cartographer will randomly determine which house which should have which shape. See, we've got 80% basic house shapes, either aligned horizontally or vertically. Then most of the rest is the L-shaped buildings, and then 3 and 2% for the more complicated shapes. You can fiddle with this, change this around as you like. But you also can say whether you want to have the houses on a fixed side of the street, or even on both sides as you go along. That way you'll fill out the one street in on both sides with one go. What I like to do, so I don't have to go back to the settings, everything is again, and also be sure that I can just fill one side with this street. I select mostly use this select side for each street setting, and that way that still works very quickly and I can just do the two sides of one street in two goes and have very good control over the placement. More, we've got roof types here, different ones again, which we can set same as in the house tool. And we can say we don't want these aligned, but basically all straight in relation to each other. Draw gardens mean we draw outlines of the lots that the buildings occupy. It's in yellow now here because my currently selected color is yellow. You normally would, no, let's cancel this and set the color back to black. And this way you should be able to see them better. Draw gardens, and there you can see the black outlines of the gardens. Can be useful depending on your city. For this city I haven't used it much, so I'm gonna deactivate it again. And here I said where the houses on which sheet they should go. Normally you don't need to mess with this unless you want to have them on some specific sheet. Buildings is normally fine. If you want even more control over your house settings, great new ones, and you can go into the street settings here, and here you can set what roof types, roof colors, bitmap fills you want, how large the buildings are, how far away from the street, how far away from the center of the road they are, and lots of different things. This is how you create the different settings here. For example, this is our default settings. Just take a look at this with the house width min 12 and max 18 feet. And if I take a look at the default large setting, street settings, you can see it's a bit larger from 15 feet to 24 feet. And this way you can create street settings for different house sizes and other options. Again, you can set a percentage from which roof type or which roof colors and roof bitmap fills the command should choose. Slate roof is here the dominant one with 60%. And multiple ones with random choosing, a fixed one. You can also set it to always use the current setting. That means you select the house style and the street command will use that. Can also be useful. And here you can also go into the house settings again, and if you want to create some changes and create new ones, you can set them here. Let's take a look how this works. I'm going to choose the medium buildings. And then I click the street command. Click here. And as you can see, shows me the outlines of the buildings it's going to place down. And here we are. And let's show you a bit. Sue asked that she wants to know more details about the street settings. Let's take a look at these and see how you can fiddle with these. So let's undo this, remove these, click in the settings again, and click in the street settings. Say I wanted to have the houses closer together. I saw there were pretty big gaps between the houses. I want them closer together. So what I can do, I can set change the distance between the houses. Let's take a look. We've got a campaign of a varies these, so we have min max settings and so on. So say half this size. I always don't bother too much about the exact numbers myself. I tend to go from the ones in there and then choose relative options. So I'm just saying I want to narrow gaps between the houses. So I'm just halving these values here for the moment. Have a look. And you can also see in the preview already that the houses are much closer together. So let's save this into our custom setting as well. So I'm not overwriting any default ones. Okay, and have another go and see whether we can actually see the difference. And yes, we can see the houses are already much closer together. Nice, I like this. Again, if I want to some changes. Let's have a look here. Speed settings. The what you need here is the house length always needs to be larger than the house width. So if we wanted to make the house width larger, say 24. Well, actually, no. Let's have a look. We might need. It does warn us now. Min house length has to be greater than the max house width. No, I don't want to keep this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change this to a little bit larger, 25. See how the difference looks. And see, we have much wider buildings now. Width is the length along the road. Length is the size away from the road. And speed settings. So that I felt this was a bit wide. I want them rather to be smaller again. So I'd say 16 and 17 here. Have a look. Oops, that didn't hit the road there. There we go. That's looking quite good for what I want. So, say I wanted to have a pure thatched roof street. I'd go in the street settings and say I want only one setting and choose thatch aged setting. Only one, I don't really need to put in the percent in there. I can make it over that do it itself. And now all my buildings will have the thatched roof. Let's put a few down here. We are, and we've got a little bit of overlap here. What we can always do, because again, these are all individual buildings, all groups that you can just move around and put them in the proper place. So what you might be seeing here a bit at times is little extensions of, okay, no, we're good. They disappear if you zoom in of colors. This is because of underlying color shapes that the buildings have, how these works and how you can hide them. I'll show you in a moment. But for now, this is just a zoom issue because some vector lines will show up underneath the bitmap edges, but these will not be visible on exports or anything. It's just an artifact normally when you zoom around in Kanban Cartographer. You can see they change as you change your zoom level. So that was our street tool. We don't need to fill out lots of the town in here because we've done much of the work already. So let's take a look at the colors I was mentioning and how you define symbol house functions or building functions for Kanban Cartographer, because it has some neat options to show cities in different ways. If we take a look at this city menu, we've got stuff like color buildings, and under layers are buildings with shading. These might be a bit arcane if you haven't read the City Designer 3 manual. They're all explained in there, but they're not used that often nowadays, so they might not be familiar to everyone. Yeah, let's first start out by see the, if I remember correctly, the structures colors setting has the No, it doesn't already. Let's first just simply take a look at one of the groups and see how it is made up. That's probably the best first step to do. We have info list, click on our house edge, and let's have a look what we can see. We are on the sheet buildings, and we know that our house has been placed on the building sheet. It is a group with a tech number. If we wanted to, we can select it by this. And then the first back there in the background is a polygon on the standard layer. That's because we've been working on standard, which is not actually that good to do, but still. We can always work with that and change this later. Then we've got stuff on the structures shading layer. Everything that starts with structures is the layers that make up the bulk of the actual house group, like the roof lines and the different roof edges and the sides and everything. See, lots of that is individual paths for the black lines, and then shading entities for the coloring of the roofs. The paths again, line, this is all the outlines. The shading entities basically are made up of individual entities again. So it's a lot of stuff in one of these symbols, or in one of these building groups. But you'll notice that most of the stuff on here is on shading. And on shading, you've got everything in the roof itself. So let's see what happens if we hide the shading layer. See? Only our yellow outlines appear. And the roofs themselves are hidden from view. And we can make use of that to show the colors to indicate building functions, like an overview map where a modern street map for buildings are keyed to their function by the color on the map. Think this might not be quite set up as other city maps this style, but so it might be a bit harder to hide these the yellow buildings. But what we can do here, we can actually do, we just have to hide this standard layer. Should probably actually be these shapes on City Designer 3 maps on structures color. But that doesn't make that much difference here now for the moment. If we just hide the standard layer, we hide the yellow artifacts beneath the roofs. But we do need the colors for our further work on the building functions. And for that, I'll show the layer again. So how do we define symbols for different functions? Basically, we first got to tell Campaign Cartographer somehow where on what layer, what function the building actually has. Campaign Cartographer does have to know it in some way. And how do we do that? We do that through the layers. Basically, we put the buildings, when we draw them, or parts of them, on specific layers, which we then can assign colors. That's City Designer maps have lots of layers, starting with the building tag at the front. This specific style has them, most of them, removed, because it wasn't really in use when creating the style. But that's quite convenient, actually, because I can show you how to set these up and create your own building layers. So we've got the basic building house layer, and what we're going to first do, we're going to move all our stuff which is just drawn randomly and started not bothered about the layer we were working on the proper layer. What you can't do, you can't just use change layer on the building because it's a group and it will just put all the parts of the building, of the house, on the that new layer you're choosing, and that basically breaks the functionality of the buildings and the houses. So for that we do have a specific command. We have the command change house layer. That's for moving houses from one function layer to another function layer. That's important to remember. If you want to change the functional layer of a house, don't use change layer. Instead, use the change house layer command from City Designer. And to grab all the houses easily, what we're going to do, we're just going to hide everything but the building sheet for now. So see, we've got all our buildings here, just the buildings. And then we're going to do that, what we said. We're going to use city, change house layer, everything here. Do it. And the new house layer is the one building layer we have on here. Well, one of two, building house one. And the change has been made. You can't see any real difference now, or for the moment, because we've just changed them in some internal stuff. So we're going to show everything again. Zoom into our section again. So what we now have all our houses on a basic building houses sheet. Now I want to add a new function, something to differentiate some buildings from others. Say I wanted to highlight some ints. So I'm going to do building and create a new layer, call it building in. Choose this as the current one. And now I'm going to move, use change house layer, and I'm going to move my big sprawling building. Do it and choose the new building end layer to put that on there. Hasn't changed really anything. I can take a look. Layers, at the moment I'm all buildings with shading. Okay, that's there they show up. Okay, let's have a look. No, that doesn't work on here. Okay, the command actually expects the normal City Designer layers. That's why we got some messages about missing layers, but no problem. We're just gonna show all buildings with color for the moment to show you the color of the buildings. That basically what it does, it hides the shading layer on all the house commands. And here we are. The buildings we've drawn, and they are showing at the moment just the colors that were our current colors when we created them. Some we had the black color selected when we drew the big one here at the start. We had yellow. Last time we were drawing the other houses, they're obviously drawn with the dark brown or orange brown color selected. So that's what's showing up. But I want to define colors for their functions. For that, I'm gonna bring up the city color buildings command. And here we've got a list of layers that we can add. And at the moment, we just have had the house one, the original one we had in here. What we gonna add a new one. And basically, we're saying which of the layers we have in our map should be colored in certain ways. And we have created the new building in. And we don't want to make it black. Instead, we want to make this a dark, darkish yellow to nice difference from the green ones. All good. And then I'm just going to use change now. And there's our color change. Now, Campaign Gatherer has taken all the buildings that were on the house one sheet and given them the green color. And all the ones on the in buildings in layer and given them the yellow color. Well, got one strange one up here, which I'm not quite sure. Ah, this is probably something with a shadow effect. Oh, It's from last time, so we're not gonna bother about this for now. And this way we can basically go in and use the layers functions, go with all buildings with shading, and there's our roofs again. Let's take a look at one of the buildings. And here you can see the color rectangle or color polygon that was underneath is now not on the standard sheet anymore, but on the building's house one sheet. And that's how CAMMAKER knows this house is on building one. So I want to assign a color to that. It's going to change all these and only the polygons, not the whole house building, but just the polygon on the building's house one sheet into the color we've defined as the one for that function. And if you want to get rid of the color artifacts in the base, we can just go in and hide these colors, color layers. And you can see that we've gotten rid of them. We've also already written off on of some of the other buildings in there. And this way you can go in and add further building sheets. Say I wanted to do a building say Smiths. So people always, role players in cities always go to the Smiths to buy weapons and repair their gear and stuff. So you'll probably need these in some way on the map. So I'm gonna put in the new layer and then say symbols city, change house layer, say this is our Smith, Steve will do it, building Smiths. And then I can go in. Normally you would first assign more buildings to all the different functions before you go in and do the coloring stuff. Here again, I'm gonna add. We can also do multiple ones in one go. Give this a color, say orange brown. Change now. And there's our color coding again. This would show up immediately because we have our shading showing. And we can also go in and do all buildings with color. Got to do get rid of some of the messages here because I don't have all the typical layers included on the map, and CAMMAKER brings some warning messages, but it works just fine. And this way you can do a version of your map with the pretty view with the shaded roofs and all the bitmap fills and print that out, and then also have a reference map with the color options for the buildings to show to your players to see where they want to go and what the buildings are. Update it as you go along, your map, your city perhaps changes, or the players get new information and create new versions of that map that way. I used to do this a lot when I was running games with lots of city adventures and stuff, and that was always fun to have around. I haven't done one of these in a while, so I probably should go back to doing that again. But nowadays you often get mapping in the game for the games myself that often anymore. I often use pre-created settings and adventures, and then they already have their maps, and I don't recreate them, which I should probably do, but you know, time. All right, let's go back to our shading settings, the pretty view. There we are. Let's have a look. What else? Okay, Sue asked me to add an Cheat effect to the building sheet to change the color ring of the buildings. Let's have a look. Yes, you can do that, of course, as well. If you want to just change the colors, go into the building sheet, add U. Where are we? Just U saturation level in here, and you can adjust color settings here. I don't know numbers by heart, but say you wanted to saturate the colors more, you can add a 20% saturation and make it a little darker, 10%, apply, and see you've got more of a greenish blue with U in here, if I see that correctly. See the green is becoming even stronger. See the green in there. Go higher, I turn into the blue, and so on. Now you can change your colorings of the buildings this way, reducing, changing the hue in the other direction, gives you to purple and reds. And you can play with around with this until you've got this color setting that you like. You can, of course, also use other options, like using RGB matrix, or for the stuff like sepia settings, and increasing darkness and lightness of the buildings, and so on. We've got another question from Quentin about the distance from the road edge to the houses. Yes, let's take a look there. We've got a nice section of road where I can still work on. Let's go down here. So let's have a look. Go to the roads section, or custom roads with the thatched roofs, into the street settings, and street width basically defines, I think, the width of the actual distance of the house and the distance from the center of the road. Let's have a look. All this looks. The street width has to be greater than the max house length. Yeah, so we've got a 30 here. At least, let's have a look how we see the differences. See, this way they're fairly close to the road. Let's have a quick measurement whether we are really at the 5 feet distance. Info distance, if I go from the edge of info distance from to here. Yeah, it's pretty close. Didn't do an exact measurement. We're close to 5 feet. So what we're gonna, if I undo this and to show the difference, go to the street settings and take a much larger difference, say 25 feet from the distance of the road. You can't really see it in the preview because the preview doesn't have a road in itself in there. See, we are much farther away from the road and much harder to do anything there. So this is definitely too far away. Or if you wanted to go very close to, you can also go to zero. See, now we are basically pretty much in the middle of the road because the distance to the center of the road is zero. That's how to define the distance of your buildings from road. I think you don't really need to mess with the road width setting itself, but let's have a look and try out what happens if we can't make it any smaller, because we need to be larger than the max length width, say street width. What happens if we do set it to 60? Preview always changes, but that's just because it chooses another different set of random buildings. Okay, still, I think it might. Actually, I'm not too sure how they have normally not really bothered much with the street width setting. So we say, what happens if we ignore the warning about the max health width and draw it anyway? Then we are pretty much on the road again. Not really much difference. So, what I would recommend is just leave that at the default. So just okay, oops, that was the wrong one. Here we go, 30, just a little bit more than the max house length. And then set your distance from the road with that setting. And you're good to draw your buildings alongside the street. There we are. Olon has that's a very general question about using C++ maps in virtual tabletops as Foundry or Roll20. I think did we already do a video on that at some point? Or I think, or it might have been in a blog article or something. But we certainly did something on just exporting stuff. Because what you normally do is just do JPEG and or PNG export and import that into the virtual tabletops, because that's the format they mostly use, and it's fairly easy and basic. Nothing special about that. Yeah, Remy had that. Has a very good issue on that topic. Probably should pop it into the chat later when I find it, or Remy perhaps has it available and can put a link in the chat. Yeah, so that's been playing around with the street and house symbols. We've got the very nice the color settings we've been playing around with. We've got the big sprawling in we've created. Just disable the saturation setting again. And if I'm bothered about the artifacts showing up on here, I can just hide the building in layer and the yellow will not be visible. But as I said, it's just because of the pixel display on the screen. When you export it at a high enough resolution or print the map, it will not show up. I have one other question. What's the purpose of the color palette under setting in the house screen? Not quite sure what you mean. Is that in the house settings? These ones here? These are basically, if you use solid colors, then Kapenka will use these ones, and the polygons that it created get these colors assigned. Because they have bitmap fills, the colors would not normally show up, but you can select the entities through that those colors. And it's mostly a leftover from the older versions where you use more solid colors on the roofs and not bitmap fills. And there the coloring was obviously very important. I'm not quite sure that is what Patrick was referring to. If it's not what you meant, let me know. Yeah, varicolor only works with those settings. Basically, varicolor doesn't work on the house buildings as such anyway. You need to define different settings for the different color versions. Varicolor works with the symbols. And house symbols is something else a little bit again, but that's something that goes too far. I can't cover any more in this session. I hope that was enlightening a little bit. Yeah, thanks for the William. Well, you do have a lot more control over what you get out of campaign cartographer. Not saying that there aren't other awesome software that also does great stuff, but from you do have a lot of control in here. You can create your own styles, and that way can create lots more different maps. All right, that should be it for tonight. Hope you liked the session, and you like the session. And I'll be away for the next 2 weeks. I'll be on holiday for a while, but Remy's gonna take up the slack and do the next video sessions if he can. And I hope you enjoy the stuff he does. And see you again when I'm back from my holiday. And all the best to you. Have a good evening or good day wherever you are. Keep on mapping and see you around. Bye bye.